before the flood hits. All right. Father, we thank you. Give you praise. We give you glory in Jesus' name. We thank you, God, for every good and perfect gift. All comes from above. And we thank you, God, that we are the righteousness of God. Has made sin for us. And we knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God. Father, we thank you for tasting death for every man. Thank you, God, you and Father, for making it possible for us to experience immortality, abolish death, delivered us from the power of darkness. Father, we thank you today for all of the rights and privileges that we have in Christ. We thank you for all of the promises. All of them are yea and amen. We give you praise and glory, hallelujah, for all that you have done for us, all that you have wrought for us through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you today for your grace is sufficient. And we are what we are because of the grace of God. Father, we thank you that you're able to cause whatever measure of grace that we need to abound toward us. So we will have sufficiency in everything. The grace of God that brings salvation hath appeared unto all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, that we can live righteous, godly, and soberly in this present world. You've already paid the price. You have already delivered us, hallelujah, from all iniquity. Our grace will save. Our faith will save through grace. We give you praise and glory tonight in Jesus' name. We thank you, God, for all that pertains unto life. Oh, God, your blessings are so numerous we can't even begin to enumerate all of the things that you have blessed us with in heavenly places, and all of the things that you have given us that pertains unto life and unto godliness. Lord, we thank you that you have given us the fullness of your Godhead. Everything that you did through Christ, God. Father, you have made it possible for us to receive of his fullness and grace upon grace. We thank you, Father, for hallelujah, all authority that's been given to us. Yes, we lost it through Adam, but we regained it through you, Father. And Jesus paid the price, fought the battle, and won the victory. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord, today that we've been bought with the price. Yes, we've been delivered from the power of darkness. Lord, we glorify you in our bodies. Yes, we worship you in spirit and in truth. We rejoice in Jesus Christ. We have no confidence in our flesh. Father, all of this that you have done for us, hallelujah, has not been of ourselves. Not of, yes, lest any man, not of works, lest any man would boast. It's because of your grace. Your grace. Your grace is sufficient. Hallelujah. We thank you tonight. Hallelujah. And through the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness, we reign. Yes, we are above only, we are not beneath. We give you praise, we give you the glory this evening for all that you have made us. Hallelujah. We thank you, Father, that we are overcomers in this life. Hallelujah. We thank you, God, for abolishing death and bringing to light life and immortality. We give you praise and glory. In Jesus' name. Obinishende. A name that has been highly exalted and lifted above every name. Who love righteousness and hated iniquity. Lord, hallelujah. You exalted him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, he has been exalted above all, every name in the universe, far above principalities and powers, mights, dominions, thrones, and every name that has a name, and that name has been given to us. Father, we give you praise and glory, and we pray in the name. We demand our rights in the name. We worship and give you glory in the name. Hey, we preach remission of sin, repentance and remission of sins in your name. Hallelujah. All that we do in word and in deed, we do it in your name. Father, we thank you for healing and salvation, which is in no other name given unto men, whereby we might be saved. Hallelujah. The stone the builders rejected, hallelujah, has become the chief cornerstone. Father, we thank you tonight for who you are and what you are and what you have done. We give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Well, all right, everybody enjoying the rain? Okay, everybody should have this glorified body, this glorified Christ. Okay, the reason why we started with the glorified Christ, we are doing the book of Acts. I guess everybody can have the handouts that we have done on the connection handout. I think every believer's added to the Lord's. Everybody should have that. And the other one that I handed out was the unceasing emphasis on the resurrection of Christ throughout the book of Acts and the epistles. If you don't have that one, we got some more of those.
What's the title of it now?
The connection, the connection of a constant Holy Spirit refilling and the occurrence of miracles in the book of Acts.
That's the title of the amendment.
Yeah, and then we have page 48 added to that. We have page 48. Things we're dealing with, we started out with the glorified body of the glorified Christ. And the second part, we're going to deal with the promise and fulfillment, I believe, and the death and resurrection of Christ is going to be, I believe, number three. I can't remember all. Number four, the name of Jesus. All of those are going to be chapters that we're going to. I got another lesson to hand out tonight. Those are chapters we're dealing with. All of the pertinent things that transpired in the book of Acts that enabled them to be so successful in their ministries. And we started with the glorification of Christ because the chapter one begins with Christ being just being risen from the dead, showing himself 40 days by many infallible proofs, and then he ascended to the Father, and then the Holy Ghost was sent back on the day of Pentecost. So we wanted to understand Christ being glorified, and because Christ was glorified, the famous scripture that all of us probably remember, 2 Timothy 1:9-10, that he abolished death and he brought to light life and immortality. That was the results of his glorification in a nutshell. He brought life and immortality to light. So we know a whole lot about life, amen. Abolished death, spiritual death, destroyed the power of physical death to rule and reign forever, because death, physical death, will be overcome when we are glorified. Amen. So we have deliverance from spiritual death. Everybody say spiritual death.
Spiritual death.
And we have deliverance from what? Physical death. And we have deliverance from the second death, which we won't have to be dealing with, which is alienation and banishment from the presence of God forever and ever in the lake of fire. So Christ's death accomplished, abolished death. You know, that's a big issue, abolishing death, spiritual death. Pass from death to life when we hear the word, believe the word, and receive Christ as Lord and Savior. We pass from death to life. Amen. We overcome spiritual death when we are born again. Everybody agree?
Amen.
We overcome physical death when we are change from mortal to immortality, whether we're living or dead. If we're living, we'll be what? Changed without dying, right? We went over that, John 11:24-25. Those that believe on me, Jesus said, though they be dead, yet shall they what? Live. That could have a physical, a spiritual implication, but I think it was referring to when Jesus returns, those dead in Christ, those that died believing in Christ will be what? They will be, they will live. Amen. Although they be dead, they shall live. They shall be changed in a moment's time when Christ descends in the air with the trump and the voice of the archangel. And we talked about a lot of that too, but we mentioned about 1 Corinthians 15, how it's the best chapter that fully discuss the resurrection, how important the resurrection and the glorification of Christ was. And that chapter, we'll get a lot of this tonight in the handout on the review exercises, but I just wanted you to know that that chapter is very important for you to read, because it covers, it refutes the erroneous doctrine that there was no resurrection. Paul was dealing with a whole lot of Christians that were preaching false doctrine, preaching that there wouldn't be any resurrection. So Paul refuted them, because he mentioned in the first part of that chapter how all of the apostles had seen him, had felt him, had eaten with him, and had touched him, and there was infallible proofs in a period, 14, how many infallible proofs were there? It was in the first third chapter.
Third chapter.
Uh huh.
Of what?
But there were many infallible proofs.
Third chapter of.
Of Acts. That mentioned about all of the infallible proofs that prove that Jesus, in reality, the resurrection of Christ was a reality, and Paul mentioned many of those infallible proofs in 1 Corinthians 15, all right, many infallible proofs in a period of 40 days. So we concluded that at least 516 to 517, the 500 that saw him at one time, these were believers. The 12 apostles saw him, they felt him, they ate with him, they he admonished them to touch me, feel me, put your hands in my side, and you know. So he really wanted them to understand that he was a real being, glorified being. So that means that when we're glorified, Christ had what? Flesh, he had what? Bones. He was a real person, but there were some things about him that had really undergone some changes, because he could appear and disappear, right? Amen. And so he was not mortal anymore. He was what? Immortal. And that's good, because the objective of our redemption is to restore man back to the place and the position and the nature that he was before he sinned. How many remember that before man sinned, he was immortal? He was not subject to death unless he sinned. Just think what would have happened if man hadn't sinned. He would have been a perfect human being forever, without death, without sickness, without disease, without any of the imperfections that we see today in the world, because he was made a perfect human being. So God's objective was to restore back to man what he had, what he was. So the glorified form, I don't think it was glorified as we see Jesus. He doesn't seem to be. He was a glorified being to start out. But he was a perfect human being. We do know that. Is that right?
Yes.
All right. So we've gone through a lot of material, and we Paul stated in the 15th chapter, 1 Corinthians, that if Christ hadn't died and rose again, if this wasn't real, then we will have no expectation of ever experiencing life after life. There would be no hope. We'd just be dead and die like dogs or horses. Is that right? They don't have no immortality.
Except for cats.
All right. Can you think about that? If Paul mentioned, if only in this life we have hope, we have all men most what? Miserable. So there's a life, and Paul proved that. He gave all of the instances in which Jesus was actually physically seen. And he even said that, Paul even said that, I myself have seen, amen, the resurrected Christ. The resurrected Christ, the real Christ, the glorified Christ being appeared to Paul on the way to Damascus. So Paul boasted that I have even seen. So it was a lot of evidence and proof. I think that in Jerusalem, probably most people had come to the tomb. They had heard about the resurrection of Jesus, and you know how news spread. And so everybody in Jerusalem probably had seen the empty tomb, the stone rolled away, and the Jesus that they buried resurrected. That was evidence, that was factual, and you didn't have to really be a big believer to believe that. I think that the most... Some thought he was stolen, but that didn't hold in the water, right? Mm-hmm. And some thought that they had seen the figment of their imagination when it was reported. Owl stories, owl tales. It was a lot of, some said they just had a vision, a dream. But it's kind of hard to say that 500 people had the same dream or the same vision. So it was irrefutable. And I guess probably the one that believed at first, most of the disciples didn't even believe it. Most of them didn't believe it when they had all of the evidence before them that he had risen. Most of them didn't believe it. The one that first believed it without a shadow of a doubt was who?
Mary Magdalene.
John.
John was the one that, him and Peter, he said John outran Peter. Well, I think Mary was the one that reported to them that he had risen. And then Peter and them came and they ran, they went running. And when they, John outran Peter. And when they got there, John, when he, what he saw convinced him beyond a shadow of a doubt. You know, the two women that came, they came, you know, they came to prepare him for his burial or something. But they came to finish up the embalming thing. But John knew for sure what he saw. And what John saw, I guess you all already know this, that John saw that the clothes that he was had wrapped in, you know, they used to, when they embalmed people, they used certain spices, aloes, I believe, and myrrh. Mm-hmm. They used those spices, and they had a big pile of cloth that they cut up in strips, and they mixed that those spices together. Those, it was preservatives. They would mix that together and attach that to the cloth, and they would wrap up all of their members, you know, every finger, and then the arm.
Looked like a mummy?
Yeah, it looked like an Egyptian mummy. They would wrap up every member of their body, and when they finished wrapping them, it would just look like an Egyptian mummy. It was just a huge, you know, they would weigh like 100 pounds at least more than they were when they died. And the only thing that wasn't enclosed was the face. The face, and they had a napkin around the face. So it was just, and after 72 hours, it became hard as a rock, that mixture. And so when John came to the grave and saw that the napkin that was on his face had been folded up and laid over in a little slot, little place in the tomb. And when they saw that the grave clothes, there's no way a person could have gotten out of that because it was hard as a rock. And when John came and saw the only opening in that big blob of grave clothes that was always in place, nothing was torn, all the grave clothes were perfectly in their place and order, nothing had been broken. The only thing that John saw that was open was the face part, and they left that part open. They didn't wrap the face. And so Jesus had to have come out of that, those grave clothes, without tampering with any of the cloth and all of the things that he had been enclosed with.
There's another little kind of a Jewish tradition that also gave him an indication that Jesus had rose again. The cloth was folded.
Right, the cloths were folded.
Anytime Jewish people take a cloth in a restaurant, if they ball it up, that means they're not coming back.
Right.
If they fold it up and sit neatly on the table, that means they're coming back again.
When John saw that opening in that apex in that, in the grave clothes, and all of that big glob of stuff that they had wrapped him in, you know, the finger part, the arm part, the neck part, the leg part, and all of that in place, John knew for sure. He ran and told everybody that Christ has risen. He was the first one that was convinced.
Now, let me ask a question. Okay, and number two you have on here, I'm looking at Mark 16:9. It says, now when Jesus was risen early the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene. So how first is it he appeared first?
Okay, so his appearance is different from, he didn't appear first to John. John wasn't the first one. I mean, John went to the grave and saw that his grave clothes were in
place. So your question earlier, the answer was Mary Magdalene.
Yeah, Mary Magdalene. Yeah. Okay. But anyway, Mary the Magdalene was the first one that he appeared to, but the first one that was convinced and believed
was John.
All right, is that all right?
Yes, seven devils.
All right, so it's kind of interesting to know. The reason I think that the reason why Peter and John, see, Peter and John was there together, and after John saw that, you know, he knew for sure. So Peter and him agreed that, you know, they knew, and they outran everybody, and so to tell the truth, it had such an impact on them in their preaching. Until they, you know, the first sermon that Peter preached, 3,000 people were saved. He had just that much impact on Peter and John. At the gate called Peter, at the beautiful, who was there? Peter and what? Peter and John. So they were the two disciples that what they saw really impacted them, and it put a burning in their spirit to go and tell everybody that Jesus, what? Has been what? He's risen from the dead. Okay, and so 1 Corinthians is a very powerful scripture because Paul said if Christ didn't rise, then our what? Faith is in vain. Right? We can't get saved. We don't have no hope. Is that right?
Yep.
And then he said that our preaching would be in vain, our faith in vain, and our hope of immortality would be in vain. And all that Jesus came to do, there's no way that those things could ever become a reality. So he focused on that. Then he focused on the order, because Jesus rose from the dead. He says that as all died in Adam, so all will live in Christ. Then he gave the order in which we would live again and receive glorified bodies. And we mentioned that when Jesus rose from the dead, that the bodies of many of the saints that were dead in their graves, they came out of their graves and they appeared to a lot of people in Jerusalem. So it was very difficult for this for any lie concerning the resurrection to thrive in Jerusalem, because I don't know how many people the saints appeared to when they were resurrected from the dead, because they were considered as part of the first fruit. That was Paul's, he was refuting the erroneous teaching that the false teachers were teaching. But he mentioned that Christ was the first fruit. He was the first one that was raised from the dead, but he wasn't raised alone. There was a select group of Old Testament saints. We like to think of them as the old patriarchs and prophets that were strong in faith. Maybe the Hall of Famers in faith in Hebrew 11. It was a select group of them that actually got glorified bodies, and I gave you the handout to show you how the first fruits teaching. That's on page, page one of the handout. The first resurrection explained. The three stages involving the resurrection of the saints.
Now, which handout are you referring to?
All right, the glorified Christ handout. Okay, on page. Okay, I have the first resurrection explained, and the three stages involving the resurrection of the saints. The first fruit. Paul talks about that. The first fruit included Christ and the saints that got glorified bodies. the time that Christ was raised from the dead. All right, now some might get confused about Christ, the first fruit. It doesn't, it's different from the saints that Jesus went to release from paradise and that ascended in their spirits and souls, but no bodies. So everybody that had died before Christ, before Pentecost, that died believing in the blood covenant, their spirits were in paradise, which was below the earth, opposite Hades, separated by a gulf. Everybody agree with that?
Yes.
And those were the people in paradise that were waiting for the consummation of the redemption, when Christ paid the price and he defeated his arch enemy, Satan. He took his blood to the Holy of Holies. He offered his blood, and when his blood was offered, then the saints were at liberty to be released from paradise. So they were released. And I can give you a scripture to show that they were released. And I believe, so they were released from paradise in spirits, and the saints that were resurrected were released, body, soul, and spirit. So everybody agree?
And question. Right. So the saints that were in paradise, they were all released. And you're saying that there was a select group or that release group that was given glorified bodies. Mm-hmm. Okay, what happened to the remainder?
Okay, the ones that got up with bodies, glorified bodies, when Christ rose, they went to heaven. All right. I don't know whether all of them went at the same time or at a different time, but we do know that all of those that didn't get glorified bodies, they were released too. And the time frame was some was after his resurrection, and probably,
where did they go?
All right, I'm giving you the scripture where they went. All of them went to the same place. I'm gonna give you a scripture. All right, and after we get all of that down, we can give the other order, the first fruits, then those that are Christ's. That means that all of those that got saved between Pentecost and the time that Jesus comes back for his saints, they will be resurrected, or they will be changed in a moment if they're living, and they will all be caught up. That's the great harvest. And then the last part is the gleanings. And so the gleanings will be, as you have read, those that are saved in the tribulation period, and those that were martyred. Everybody's not going to be martyred during the tribulation. So there will be some saints that will go into the kingdom in their natural bodies. Okay, let me show you that scriptures in Ephesians. That's one. I'm going to show you another one. Dr. Donson might have another one. I'm going to show you the one I know. Ephesians 4:8-4, it says, wherefore he said, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Now that he ascended, what is it but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. Okay, so Christ released those that were in prison in paradise in spirits and souls, and he released those that whose spirits had to come from paradise and unite with their bodies. And we've mentioned that resurrection means that if they appeared in resurrected bodies, that means that the components of their physical bodies had to come back, they had to be regathered and reconstituted, and they had to become a real person again in order to be glorified. And all of that happened. I don't know how, and I can't describe it. You know, it was miraculous, but the scripture does say that he that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens. So when Jesus ascended, I don't know whether they ascended up with him because he went up in a cloud. They all could have gone up in the cloud with him. I mean, both companies. I mean, it's possible. Some teach that the cloud, you know, we're going to all go up in a cloud, right? So some teach that when Jesus went up in the cloud, that the saints, spirits and souls that came out of paradise, and even the glorified saints all went together. They could have gone all together, and they could have gone in different time frames. They could have gone in different time frames. But we do know they both, I'm going to tell you another scripture that will prove that they are. Hebrews 2:14, for as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that hath the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. Now that also, some scholars feel that that referred to those that were in bondage in paradise. But they were not liberated, they were not completely redeemed until Jesus offered his blood. That was the reason why when he first appeared to Mary, he said, "Don't touch me." So because he had ascended.
So in Acts 1:11, when he said the same Jesus who ascended come back, now was he glorified then?
Yes.
That's why I'm confused.
Yes, Jesus was glorified when he made all of these appearances during that 40-day period.
So why did he tell her in the beginning? That's
why he told her.
There's no indication why he went back to heaven and came back down. Remember?
Okay. Let me just kind of put it in perspective. Okay, Jesus told Mary, "Don't touch me, because I haven't ascended." Okay, after that, he appeared to Mary, and then she could touch him. So evidently, he had gone to heaven. See, Jesus ain't limited by time and space. We got to forget that. If he came out of those grave clothes, as we'll call it. If he came out of that, I mean, he can just zip up to heaven and come what? Back in a blinking of an eye.
Yeah, that's all in the spirit. But Pastor Hill, I heard preaching that there's one man between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. Uh-huh. And then I heard him say that, so the only man in heaven is Jesus. Mm-hmm. So and you're saying that those bodies had to go back up, probably went back up with him, so that would be in heaven too.
Well,
so
paradise is in heaven, but the only man between God,
the man,
Jesus Christ. You know, some say that he's the only man in heaven, but glorified man.
Different compartments.
Different compartments, but You know, the Bible didn't say the only man.
No, it didn't. That's right.
we hear some teaching.
Somebody doing mashed potatoes.
The only man. The only man in heaven. All right. Well, the only God man. The only God man in heaven. The only union of God and God and God and man in heaven. You can say that, right?
Yeah.
All right. So the order, the saints will be second in order. And remember, the resurrection, the first resurrection covers a period of how many years?
For the first resurrection?
Uh-huh.
1,000 years.
Okay, the first resurrection covers the time from Pentecost to the time that Jesus comes back. That will be a period of what? About 2,000 years, right?
Okay. Uh-huh.
Yeah. So the first resurrection, the first fruits was a part of the first resurrection. The saints will be a part of the what? First resurrection. All right. And the gleanings will be a part of the first resurrection. Everybody agree? The gleanings would be those that received Christ during the tribulation period, and many of them would be martyred, but some will go into the kingdom alive in their physical bodies. All right? And those that would be resurrected that were martyred, that will take place at the close of the, if you ran your references, from the Old Testament, of all of the references from the Old Testament saints that describe the resurrection, they place the resurrection of the Old Testament saints somewhere around the period close to the end of the 7-year tribulation period. But when Jesus brings the mighty armies of saints, armies upon armies, and angels upon angels and angels, when all come back to inhabit the earth as Jesus sent up his kingdom, it's going to be millions and millions and millions of saints, and all that have been that have died in Christ, all of them will be coming back with him. So it's going to be the saints, Old Testament saints, it's going to be what? The New Testament saints, it's going to be those that the tribulation saints, all of them are going to be coming back with Jesus. Amen. When he comes to set up his kingdom.
Pastor, do you think like a timeline chart, if you could prepare, well, I don't know, if you could prepare, or if you would ever prepare a visual of the events, the first, resurrection, the second,
see, the second, we need to not think about the second resurrection. The second resurrection does not apply. The second resurrection will take place 1,000 years after the millennium.
But what she's talking about is a timeline, like
there are a lot of charts on that.
And well, we're asking you to
the tribulation.
That.
Well, I'll find one. I'm not going to try to draw one. I'll find one. Okay, now, if you want to know about the tribulation saints, when they will be raptured, because saints will be living a long time during the tribulation, because Satan will be bound for 1,000 years. And he's going to be loose at the close of the tribulation period. I mean, at the close of the millennium period. He's going to be bound 1,000 years, and he's going to be loose for a season, and then he's going to be bound and cast into the lake of fire. And it won't be no death after the 1,000 years for saints. You know, there won't be no more death. Eternal death will be the only death that will be prevailing, and that will be the ungodly. But the Bible doesn't teach and doesn't give any specific information concerning how and when those that die during the millennium period will be resurrected. But we just can speculate that they will be resurrected at the close of the, before the close of the millennium period, because the new heaven and new earth is going to be for God's children, all of God's children. All right, so so we don't want to speculate. All we know about now is the first and second resurrection. The first resurrection covers the first fruits, the main harvest, and the gleanings, which we refer to as those that are resurrected just before Jesus brings everybody back with him to the earth to set up his millennium king at the close of the tribulation period. So it's going to be two. That's what the handout taught. It was through three companies or three troops. Anybody read that? Mm-hmm. Well, it's about time. You better read it, because you're going to have to answer some questions in a few minutes if we have time. It's about 7:30. And then at the close of the 15th chapter of Corinthians, it's a really good chapter to read, then a description of Jesus coming for his own. You know, they describe me, behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment's time, in a twinkling of an eye. So if you really want to get the fullest discussion of the resurrection, you really you can't find a fuller discussion or fuller treatment than the 15th chapter of 1 Corinthians. Everybody got that? All right, now, that all deals with abolishing death and bringing life and immortality to light. That is the light, the gospel. Even in that chapter, it explains that Christ died, he was buried, and he rose again, which is the definition of the gospel in a nutshell. Everything about the resurrection, Christ's death, burial, and resurrection is kind of a it really stands out in that particular chapter. The reason why we want to focus on not just the death part, the death and resurrection of Christ, but we also want to focus on what we have as a result of his death and resurrection. So that's going to be our focus of discussion. Let me just ask y'all this. I'll let y'all go back and forth for a while. Do you feel like the resurrection, the death and the resurrection of Christ was a greater miracle? What do you think is the greatest miracle when it comes to what God has done through his redemptive work? Do you believe that the resurrection from the dead, Jesus' resurrection from the dead, was the greatest miracles of all miracles? If not, what do you consider as the greatest miracle of all miracles?
Supernatural occurrence. It has to be the resurrection.
All right. Yeah. Brother Williams said it has to be the resurrection. All right.
I think it's the resurrection, too.
All right.
Because no one else has come from the dead, raised from the dead. Jesus is the first.
Okay. Except for Lazarus.
Mm-hmm. Lazarus died again.
But he was resurrected, but he came back from the dead.
What I was trying to say, when God created man, wasn't he the crown? I mean, didn't he make everything that exists? God did it for who?
Man.
But he was the crown of what?
Of creation.
Mm-hmm. Right?
Yes.
Okay, Brother Donaldson, you want to say something?
I was going to say the resurrection is a great miracle, but I think the greatest miracle is born-again process.
Okay.
To be born again.
Okay, because all of that God did through his redemptive work for one purpose, to abolish death and bring life and immortality to man. Amen. So man is the object of all of God's endeavors. We are here. We are the apple of his eye. We are the crown of creation. When he created the universe, everything in the universe was created with the thought of what? Giving man everything that pertains unto life and to God.
That man is the person, it's that man, Christ Jesus, mm-hmm. that everybody is rising through. Mm-hmm. Oh, because without that man being resurrected, mm-hmm. there is nobody else being resurrected. So
we can say the greatest miracle probably is a person that is spiritually dead. Just think about the life of Apostle Paul. And I don't think that you could find a person.
But without this death, burial, and resurrection.
Okay, but the death, burial, and resurrection was for the purpose of restoring man. Mm-hmm. So was that the greatest miracle, or was the man receiving? See, the Bible says when he was delivered up for our offenses, mm-hmm. and he was justified when Christ, he was raised again, mm-hmm. for our justification. Mm-hmm. All right, so everything that God did, it was directed toward what? It was for the purpose of restoring man back to all that he had what? Lost and forfeited through Adam's disobedience.
But you got to get faith in that man being raised. Not whatever anybody else. I'm not impressed by anybody else's salvation. I'm impressed by his resurrection.
All right, but I think the greatest miracle that history has ever recorded has been. The reason why we think of the resurrection as being the greatest miracle, but because that appears, that registers with our sense knowledge. Mm-hmm. But when a person goes from death to life, like Jesus is a type, like he was down in the lowest pit of hell. He had been judged. The sins of the entire universe was resting upon him. And he was being judged. And the intensities of his suffering was meted out probably in proportion to all of the sins that ever man had ever committed. So Jesus was under a heavy load. Why did Jesus scream and cry to ask God, Lord, if it's your will, let it pass from me. Yeah. Jesus knew that the intensity of that experience was going to be, you know, he knew everything from the beginning. He knew as God how much suffering and the intensity of how intense that suffering would be. He knew that. That's the reason why he did everything that he could. And he was struggling, said, Lord, if you can find any other way. Mm-hmm. And he even sweated drops of blood. I mean, it was a real difficult experience. Most martyrs don't even recall like that. Because most martyrs that you read about in the early church, They did it joyfully. I mean, they rejoiced that they were counted worthy to suffer and to be killed for the sake of the gospel. And they were singing, they were praising God, and they were facing death. But Jesus facing death was different.
Making my point.
Jesus' death was different. So what I'm saying is that
and you're saying salvation is great. Mm-hmm.
What I'm saying is that when it comes to sense knowledge, the physical resurrection of Christ, mm-hmm. The resurrection of Christ probably would register more to sense knowledge. But to revelation knowledge, seeing it from a spiritual perspective, you would say, why did it read, you read the scripture last Sunday, it pleased God.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I mean, God was, I mean, it satisfied all of the demands of justice. I mean, God was just to himself, God was just to Satan, God was just to man. So all three areas, the demands of justice were satisfied. That pleased God.
Yeah.
So it was something that God really wanted to happen.
Yeah.
Absolutely. All of that you're talking about is the death, burial, and resurrection.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
All right. The agony that you described, all of that.
Mm-hmm.
Now, earlier you mentioned about Paul and being receiving salvation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, if you think about it, for us to receive salvation, today, what do we have to do? What do we have to do?
You have to believe, not in your sense.
Right, you have to
believe in your heart.
Yes,
heart. Uh-huh.
As Romans 10:9-10.
Uh-huh.
I'm going to venture to say, you know, I could be wrong, that a person that receives Christ today, is that does not equate to what Christ went through, what you described.
Okay. Okay, now when you think about the many, when you think about the multitudes of crises that result from the born again experience, the multitude of people that have been saved, because Paul in his ministry, about half of the known world was received the gospel.
Yeah, but I was just thinking about an individual.
Okay, well, let me just settle this for all,
okay,
once and for all.
To
the senses, to the senses, the physical resurrection of Christ is the greatest thing, fact, recorded in history, when you look at sense knowledge, from the perspective.
Also spiritually?
But when you look at, in the spirit realm,
maybe don't get it in the spirit.
I think what's going on, what you say is absolutely true.
Okay.
Everybody's saying, but we're missing one little fine little point.
What is that?
Get a strict there.
Define the word miracle.
Uh-huh.
If we could simply define the word miracle, you're taking nothing and turning it into something. Then the greatest miracle of taking nothing and turning it into something is you being created into a new creature. You being saved, born again. The born again process, not of the process of you confessing your sin, but actually taking your spirit and turning it into a new creature, is probably the greatest miracle that ever happens on this earth.
On earth, it's a qualifier.
On earth, we don't know what's going on.
It's all time. All time.
But the greatest event that ever happened on this earth was the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ.
All right, absolutely.
Miracles versus events.
Right.
All right.
But you said the senses of the resurrection. You know, the resurrection is to our senses, but the spirituality of it is that the reason why my visual perception is, the reason why Jesus agonized so much of having to go through the crucifixion was because he's taken on everybody's sin.
Mm-hmm.
Now, from the spiritual point of view, that means that every demon that was in hell was on him.
Mm-hmm.
So that means every part of his body had a sin, a demon hanging upon him. And I think that was more agonizing to have a demon on you, not just one, but all of the sins of the world. And that's spiritual because we didn't see that.
You can't see it, right.
You know,
right.
So that is spiritual part. It's not just the senses part. And that's why I said that the resurrection would be the greatest miracle, because Jesus had to take all of that on, you know, and then the Holy Spirit came with all the power.
And then there was
and brought him out of that.
And then there was a time that his will didn't matter. And that was once he was down there. Once he was down there, and, above the earth, he says, but once he was in the grave, in hell, his will didn't matter. He was taking it. And then it was it was God, the Father, that made him alive. And then down there, that's when he got the victory.
we can include them. Both of them were great miracles.
So that was the...
There you go.
And as you say, on earth, well, on earth is a difference then.
That ends the debate. They both were great miracles.
Okay, but I think that a revelation of what happened during those 3 days will actually make a great import on every person. And I think that the reason why we wanted to start out with a discussion on why he was glorified. Okay, now we want to, maybe from this point, why was Christ glorified? Why did he receive a name above every name? Why was he exalted far above all power, principality, power, and might? Why did he receive everything that he had created? You know, God created everything through Christ, right? Why did he receive everything that he had created through Christ as a man? Okay. So, see, when he was this day, he inherited a name above all names, and this day thou art my son. You know, he begat Jesus. So everything that he had created was conferred upon him as a man when it comes to the creation that Adam forfeited, that man had authority over. That authority over the entire creation was given back to Christ as a man, not as God. Okay, because, and he didn't need it for himself, because he opposed all things by the word of his power. He's at the right hand of God now. If you look, go back in 2,000 years, you've never seen one time that Jesus had to use his name to do anything down here on earth. His name has been given to us. And because he did what he did, I think that there are three things that we will discuss that he, usually when people get great names like Jesus got, it's normally because of achievements. Is that right? People achieve outstanding things, and then, you know, that's by merit. And then sometimes people get names from conquest, like kings. They defeat great, nations. So they receive a name as a conqueror, because they, overcame a whole lot of countries that were opposed to them through conquest. And thirdly, this is all in, I'll be the name of Jesus' book, through inheritance. There are three ways that people get great names, and Jesus got a great name all three ways. And we got to get a revelation of that. It's going to take a lot of study for that to soak in. So we just have to chew on it little by little. But when that name, amen, really begins to register in the power, and when you can see the fullness of the Godhead in that name, when you can see that the all of the unlimited resources in the universe in that name, when you see that all authority in heaven and in earth is in the name, when you get a revelation of that, I think that you are good to go, and you are ready to operate in the supernatural. Amen. So I'm going to, y'all are here, y'all seem to be so studious tonight, so I'm just going to bless y'all. I'm going to let you go after this. I'm going to give you a lesson, because right now we're going to work on the things that we were discussing at the close of the session here. And we're going to get some really revelation on the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, the sufferings of Christ. Okay, everybody take one of those, and you can work those out. And I guarantee you, this is going to equip you to receive a special revelation on the power of his resurrection and the power and the authority in the name of Jesus. Amen. The plan of redemption is something that you really want to fully understand, and I think that this handout is focused on the plan of redemption. Why Jesus went through all of this, why he achieved what he did, why he was able to conquer Satan, why did he get a name above every name? And this is at the root of our salvation, the death, burial, and resurrection. And when you understand that, you will become a terror to the kingdom of darkness. Tonight,
it's a question. Since, you know, when Paul got in trouble in the book of Acts, he said, because I preached the resurrection. Why do you think that the Jews, even to this day, have a, they just don't believe? According to Romans 10 and 11, Paul's still praying in Israel. So, you know, what's got them, we know the devil has them blinded now, according to the scriptures, but what was the real holdup for them? Israel, yeah, what's the big holdup? Are they?
You had the Sadducees and the Pharisees. The Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection at all, even back then. Okay. And the Sadducees and the Pharisees believed it, but they didn't understand it. They didn't understand it that it would come through Christ. So they had the attitude of looking for a redeemer that would kick the Romans out of the country and bring it. So they weren't looking for it in the spiritual sense, but they had a sense that there would be a resurrection.
Yeah.
So you had this conflict going in the Jewish religion and still going on today.
They haven't accepted.
And because of that, and they're falling away from God, that opened the door for the devil to come in and set blinders on them and set them up for where they are today.
That's right. They didn't accept the gospel, the doctrine of Christ's resurrection. That was a big deal with the Sadducees. They didn't, that was a big sect that opposed, the Pharisees.
Okay.
And that was part of it. But during the tribulation period, I think that that's the time that many of them are going to come and embrace the Messiah and get saved.
The
tribulation period is going to be a factor in them turning to Christ and
the tribulation
and overcoming all of those.
Will that be Gentiles bringing them in, or how?
It's going to be 144,000 Jewish preachers.
Kind of simplified. Part of the breakdown is that because of our acts in the Holy Spirit, it's going to make them jealous. And that jealousy is going to open their eyes to a point to where they want to get curious as to what we have that they don't have. And then the resurrection is going to come in. The Bible says, right now, when all these things start happening, then the blinders will fall off. And they begin to see. And then that's when 144,000 evangelists are going to get a lot of Jewish people saved.
Yeah, there's going to be tons of Jewish.
Some of them believe now.
Oh, yeah, it's happening now. Yeah. We got a movement now called the One Man Movement, where you got, they got a name for it. They're Christian Jews.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, on next week, whether you have it filled out or not, we're going to go over this glorified course. I'm going to start going over all of this and discussing all of these. So you have 20. Things that you're going to have to deal with next week, and we're going to let you grade your own papers, and everybody save, and
I'm a great partner.
It's going to be kind of tricky. You better read this good and look it up, and we're going to discuss this in the class, so everybody will be on the same page. So the second lesson, you can begin to work on that if you have already completed the first one. All right, we're going early tonight, 10 minutes early.
waters coming out of the
flood. We don't want nobody to be in the flood.
I already went through the flood. Went to the flood to get here.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That